And while America has had its attention virtually fully occupied by China virus and also by the massive riots and protests and burning and looting and everything else that has gone on in major American cities, the subject of Hong Kong has faded off the front page. I thought we'd talk about that with Lieutenant Colonel Jay Carafano, former member of the Trump transition team and Heritage VP for National Security. Colonel, good to have you back.
Hey, great to be with you.
I know we're distracted. I know Capitol Hill's, you know, Capitol Hill's capable of, I think, focusing on one or maybe one and a half issues at any given time. Despite having 535 of them, they can't do division of labor sufficient to take on more than one front in each political war. So what should we be doing about Hong Kong as China essentially says the 50-year agreement just became a 23-year agreement and the rest of it is over and we're simply going to take Hong Kong?
Right. Well, first of all, I would say I think this administration hasn't been distracted on Hong Kong. They've been doing the right thing. So for folks who may not be intimately aware of this, so China transferred Hong Kong to Britain as a colony. Britain transferred it back, which meant that sovereignty was returned to Hong Kong. When they did that, they passed something called the Basic Law, in which the Chinese government agreed that it would be basically called one country, two systems. So essentially, Hong Kong could keep the political and economic freedoms that they enjoyed under the British. Now they're on the path to completely abrogating that deal, essentially breaking the commitment that they made to people who are Chinese citizens with the a new national security law they've been passing. Hong Kong is literally the canary in the world's global mine shaft, right?
Yep.
If this is how China treats its own people, then the rest of the world knows how China will treat them. So by paying attention to this, we are, one, holding China accountable. And this is, I think, really important. If the people of Hong Kong are not going to get flattened by a pancake, this essentially global condemnation of what the Chinese government is doing is the only hope that maybe the Chinese company will back off, they'll push this off, they'll water down the law or whatever. But we know that if we walk away, the Chinese Communist Party will just roll over these people. The other thing that's important is that this is an object lesson for the rest of the world. If this is how they treat their own people, if this is how they meet obligations to Chinese citizens, then the rest of the world knows what they can expect from doing business with China.
Well, and see, that was the second piece of this, because even if people say, I don't care what happens with Hong Kong, I don't care what happens with Taiwan, if you look at it as a litmus test for does China honor its agreements? Because remember, this agreement is very significant to Hong Kong, and at least it's an emblem of whether or not we can trust the Chinese on anything else. If we say to the Chinese government, we want agreements on nuclear weapons, or we want agreements on sovereignty, or we want agreements on the South China Sea, where you're building all those cute little islands and things like that, if the Chinese communists say, yeah, make them whatever promises you want, we're not going to hold to the agreements anyway, so tell them whatever they want to hear. We've all dealt with people who are like that in business in America, or at least some of us have, where you know this is somebody who can't be trusted to honor an agreement. When it comes to nations, if they communicate to the rest of the world, we'll make agreements, but we won't honor them, then the rest of the world should proceed with that in mind when you make deals with the Chinacoms.
Right. China only respects power. They, you know, fancy words, they'll throw out all the fancy words in the world. It's meaningless to them. All they care about is real power. That's why this administration has been such a thorn in their side and has been such a problem for them to deal with. Look at what this. Look, for example, about Huawei, which is it's just easier and cheaper to just buy this Huawei stuff, put it in your thing, and forget all the risks associated with that. But because the United States pushed back so hard, we've now had the United Kingdom say they're kicking Huawei out of the country. The Dutch are doing this. The Germans are thinking about doing this. And I got to tell you, these countries would not be standing up to China if the United States had led the way. We've gotten a lot of criticism for the administration for pulling out of the World Health Organization. But the reality is that because the United States stood up and pushed back on what China was doing with the WHO, other countries have stood up. They stood up for saying Taiwan ought to be readmitted. They stood up for saying China ought to be investigated, that the WHO ought to be investigated. Let's be honest. Everybody can talk all they want about China, but they fear China's power. And if the most powerful country in the world isn't willing to stand up and call the Chinese out for misdeeds, who thinks that anybody else is going to stand up and do that?
They're not going to. And Colonel, one of the things I've been suggesting it since we became aware of the really overt problems with the WHO way back in late January. They were lying to us on January 14th, no human-to-human transmission. And lately, every time they say something, you wait a day or two and they go 180 the other way a day or two later. I've suggested, and it wouldn't be a bad way to use the $400 million we're saving that we're not giving to WHO, say the United States will start an NGO, will fund it, will let anybody be a member, and here are the standards by which it'll operate. It'll operate not to advantage the United States, which is what China seems to want to do with the WHO. It will work the way the WHO, in theory, was supposed to work. It will gather information on world health threats. It'll communicate information to its members. It will expect its members to support it financially and to allow access. And when they don't allow access, we'll call them out and we'll be transparent about the information. If we were to do that, we could just supplant the WHO and replace them and kick China right in the teeth. Is there anything wrong with that idea?
Well, let's just say Lars Larson's crazy, but he's not because we actually did do that. I mean, look at PEPFAR. Okay, the United States bypassed the WHO. We set up the international effort to deal with AIDS in Africa. That has been one of the most successful world global health initiatives, and the United States did it outside everybody else. We just led the way and did it. So the reality is, yes, we can do that. Would it be better if the WHO actually did a stop? Sure, it's great. And to be honest, the president tried. He wrote him a letter. Says, here's what you need to do to clean up your act. What did they do? They ignored it. And people say we should stay in. Why should we stay in if they're not going to actually change and get better?
It doesn't make any sense. Lieutenant Colonel Jay Carafano, thank you very much. We appreciate your time and what you do. Thanks so much for the time tonight.